friends, delegates. It's nice to be here. I'm in a strange country. Your currency is money. As a family business advisor, my currency is governance and relationships. My currency is family, wealth, as beyond money. And I would like to thank Mr. Alan Duncan, who just preceded me, for setting the tone for what I'd like to say. I don't want to say too much, but I've got a lot to say, so I will say it quickly. I believe that each of you have these presentations with you, and I'm hoping that either you've already read it or you might be interested in reading it soon after. Also, I don't want to stand in the way. We have two eminent people who will participate in a panel. This is just a keynote. I am not an engineer. I don't think in a sort of very structured way. I'm a facilitator, the three words that describe me. All of that I don't remember actually much of what was said. In the here and now, I'm a facilitator. I engage with family businesses very, very deeply. I become friends, I become partner, and retain my independence. And I help owner-managed companies scale up, build up, consolidate, whatever. That's what I do, and that's what my team does. So let me move on. First, I'm going to say something from the ringside. You are all experts in family office in wealth. But as I meet and greet and work with family businesses, I get a sense of what the family office could be, would be, should be. So I think family office ought to manage family matters end to end. I'm using that as simplistically as possible. So which includes family governance, family boards, family councils, business councils, investment, divestment, risk management, research and service, succession and legal issues, grooming, onboarding the next generation, career planning, family wealth management, treasury operations, family education and learning, administrative services, conscious travel. Now, the ones in red, with my limited experience of family offices, and they're largely single family offices, and they've largely in-house family offices. I've had some engagement with other family offices and trust offices. I think a lot of treasury operations occur. I'm not sure how much wealth management occurs, and certainly administrative services, concierge, travel takes a lot of their time and focus. So my submission to all the experts here, all these experienced people here, my humble suggestion is that please, it'll be great help if you focus on building new capabilities in the family office, making family offices more multidisciplinary in their character and in their talent, because there's a lot to do and there's a whole width of things to do. Maybe partner with some family business strategists, M&A specialists, I don't know, facilitators, I don't know what else. But suffice it to say, from my point of view, whatever else you do, independence is critical. So there's a point of view that family offices should handle from banks, and I hope I'm not, you know, putting my foot in my mouth, but family offices set up by banks, there are family offices which are not related to any institution. So unless I learn any better, I am still going to suggest to family offices and to family owners that their family offices and their advisors should be independent. I hope I'm not on the wrong side of the table, but I must tell you what my conviction tells me. So very quickly, I think Mr. Alan Duncan has raised this, so I won't take too long. Family capital goes far beyond money. family relationships, traditions, values, rights, obligations, and so on and so forth. The family is a social system. And I think that kind of understanding, that kind of mindset, that space in your minds, at least the people I have met, they're few and far between. They think money, they think growth of money, they think risk, but very few of them think relationships. So I write articles for the Business Today. In one of the editions, I've said, trusting family relationships come before legal trusts. You start a legal trust, you do all the work, and then it comes to a grinding halt in its implementation. Family desire for wealth, status, and comfort weakens family business. I've seen it repeatedly. Family lifestyle expectations rise over generations. I think there's a point made by Mr. Duncan. So there's something that happens in an intergenerational point of view, and if you want to preserve wealth and you want to build on capital and wealth, it must take into account that dynamic. I'm sure so many of you do. The other point I want to make in this slide is that the holy grail for family business is one voice. I know there are different risk appetites. We've talked of risk appetite from different members, from different generations. Their entire view of wealth is different. So how do we get that one voice? Another experience that most of you know, but I'm sharing it, is that the family is most vulnerable during the transitional period, intergenerational transition. And what would you do with it? Be aware of it, and I'm sure that you can link the dots. And one of the questions I'd like to ask my eminent panelists is to help me with their vast experience of building businesses, advising, and being on boards, is how would they connect family, the pulsating family business, which is a kamadhenu for the family, with wealth management. There's a point of view that as personal wealth of family members declines, their risk-taking declines. I don't know. The biggest asset of a family, if that's what you're managing, is reputation and credibility. What you can do about it, we need to maybe open some more windows and see what we can do. So we talked of family charter, family constitutions. I help families do a lot of it. So I won't take too much time on it, except to say that essentially a family charter solves tomorrow's predictable problems today. You bring the elephant into the room, and family members sitting around the table, and in Indian families, hierarchy is very critical. I mean, the social hierarchy, the parental hierarchy. So getting the next generation to open their mouth and talk, and getting the founder to be patient and listen to the desires, aspirations of the next generation. And once that happens, then they talk. So another thing, family charters, I've looked at many. I've been accused of not doing some. So what I say to you, I've had to do myself. Some of the family charters and constitutions have been very rule-based, and I've been helped author some. And I've changed my mind, because you can always get around rules. So I'm moving towards family constitutions and family charters that are principles-based, that engage with the values, that engage with aspirations, that engage, etc. And one critical process in any charter, any family, is managing differences. I desist from using the term conflict, because I think conflict is the last stage. It starts with a small argument. If you don't address it, it becomes a difference. If you don't address the difference, it becomes a conflict. If you don't address the conflict, it becomes incompatibility. So catch it quickly, and there are processes for it. In the West, business holds family together. My learning is that in the East, the family holds the business together. And that sort of says it in as many ways as I can. I also believe that the PE model between family and the company is a very elegant way of influencing company. Families grow faster than business. It has implications for governance. It has implications for wealth management. It has implications for how and what the family will be in the future. In families, besides reputation, credibility, values that they pass on is a great asset. And as importantly, there's a saying in family business circles that net work is equal to net worth, which means the family passes on credibility, trust, and relationships for the next generation to build on, if they choose to build on. The next generation doesn't want to do traditional businesses anymore. They want to do e-commerce. They want to burn cash. And the old man says, I don't understand this, right? So there are differences in what the next generation wants to do. We know that unplanned transition significantly impacts revenue growth. So the need for planned transitions. Another quick one, organizations age when entrepreneurship declines. And so how do you retain the entrepreneurship? How do you get families to build an entrepreneurial pipeline in the family as they build a leadership pipeline in the business? These are the challenges. The rise of women, role of women in family business is something that families are having to engage with directly, right between their eyes, and many of them are doing so. In-laws coming into the business, there was a tradition that, don't bring in-laws into the business. That is changing. But that depends on how the family manages it. Some families, it depends on the family culture, give a visa to the in-law. Some families, and the new entrant has to earn his or her green card. And then after some time, they confer citizenship on this in-law. But there are many families now that are willing to offer citizenship from the moment they walk in. These are implications for information, implications for engagement, implications for membership of the family. If you take care of this, there are aspects that can be taken care of to challenge the adage that in-laws should be restricted from coming into family business. Ownership, I believe it's the most emotive decision, and you're right in the center of it. There have been loyal family confidants, and they act as the leaders of family wealth advice. So how do you get the family confidant and this professional family office advisor to be able to engage, work, and build together? Challenge. Should families build internal family professional wealth experience? Business growth needs concentration of funds. Wealth management requires diversification of investments. How do you manage this paradox? In fact, family business is all about paradox. How do you manage paradoxes? Families that have learned to manage paradox have moved from generation to generation. Responsible shareholder development, education, I think, again, Alan covered it. Much thanks to you, Alan. You've saved a lot of my time. In India, corporate and personal wealth gets mixed up a lot. What is the definition of wealth? Is it just portable assets? You are the experts. We talked of investment committees being very important. Involving the next generation in wealth management is extremely important. Though the one who has the gold makes the rules, you got to counter that, push that back. Creating a war chest for difficult times and investment potential is very, very crucial in family businesses. And I'd like to just say that when I work with families, I encourage the owner, the founder, the starting spirit to write an ethical will beyond the legal will. What has this founder learned what, and that there's this, we said, the trust is I hope I haven't got you wrong, but love, you know, transferring love and concern. Very similar in what I'm saying. How do you transfer learnings of one generation to the other? What were the values that built this business? What values are being inherited? So the ethical will is a very, very important thing. The legal will bequeaths valuables. The ethical will bequeaths values. And yeah. So purpose other than money is important. Do families have to allocate risk more than capital? There's a lot of embarrassment and fear of discussing money. So I start, you know, all the three circles. There's the business, you have to deal with the business, you have to deal with family, and you have to deal with ownership, and all of these come together in family advice. I most often start with the business or the family and or, and I come to ownership at the very last. Once trust has been built up, when conversations have started, when deeper conversations have emerged, then it's a good time to talk money. I'm really wondering, there's a whole host of people who say, separate ownership, family ownership, and management. I don't think I belong to that school of thought. I'm raising it as a question, but I actually have a statement inside me, which is, I think it's a bad idea. Because family ownership, entrepreneurial ownership brings in, provides the face, name, reputation, and the most vital part is the entrepreneurship. And so the question is not separation, the question is coexistence. How do you get these two to coexist without conflicting each other? So very quickly, all studies, Japanese, Indian, have suggested 12 rules for perpetuity. I'll take a little while longer on this one before I conclude with the last slide. One, having studied businesses, family businesses that last long, one, what do we learn? Leadership driven by clear values, vision, and mission. Those families have a better chance of perpetuity. Long-term strategic approach, portfolio renewal is very critical for perpetuity. Importance of people and human merit system, mind you, human merit system, not nepotism, heralds chances of perpetuity. Anything that you're involved in which builds the nation, builds the economy. Anything that you're involved in, the society must give you permission to exist. Families which are socially minded tend to live longer. Families which are committed to continual improvement live longer, last longer. Families which deal with frugality and the efficient use of resources, very important. So many family members proclaim frugality. They want the professionals to be frugal, but their lifestyle is not frugal. Dealing with this dichotomous situation is important. And wealth erodes, lifestyle erodes, people get used to high standards of living, unlike the founders. They are more interested in being chairman of FICCI or IMA or Rotary. That takes more of their attention than managing the business, which is their kamadhenu. They like status. They have somebody now. And that somebodyness, the moment that ego, that somebodyness has come in, rest assured, if they're not able to manage it, the family business will decline, unless something else happens. Also, families need to be in the bridge of global finance. You can't be at the periphery of global finance. So, simple thing, families don't want to be mobile. They've set up their family in Calcutta, Saturday club, golf. Wife comes from the same city. Why should I move? My operations, they are in Chennai. They're in Visakhapatnam and somewhere else. So remote management doesn't work, at least not in India. So some of these issues of mobility of family members to the center, to the mandi, doesn't happen. Conservative financing, very important. And what efforts do families take to embody legacy, to pass on legacy? So if you have a family governance model that helps, and finally, if you're able to stay below the radar of the media, media can be extremely disruptive. It can disrupt families, it can disrupt whatever they touch. So credibility and reputation is very important. I'm sorry for being so forthcoming and so frank. If I don't share my convictions with you, I don't think I should be standing here. So last one. So what are we really doing in family governance? Strong family values and governance and relationships helps strong family governance. Strong family governance helps strong corporate governance. And when family governance and corporate governance come together, an institution starts to form. And when institutions gallop pace, perpetuity is possible. Thank you. I'm suggesting, in the interest of time, we take the questions later, so if you can hold your thoughts as I invite my fellow panelists, and we can take it forward. Thank you.
So moving on to the panel discussion. So please welcome our next panelist, Mr. A. Velumani, the creator and MD of Thyrocare. So please come on the stage. So he is a BSc in chemistry from the University of Madras and has an MSc in biochemistry from the University of Bombay and a PhD in thyroid physiology from the University of Bombay. He has over 35 years of experience in thyroid biochemistry, in diagnostics, research and business. After 15 years of experience in thyroid biochemistry research at Baba Atomic Research Center, which is in Mumbai, he started Thyrocare in 1995. Using a unique business model in a focused biochemistry back-end laboratory, he has built an organization which got listed in National Stock Exchange in May 2017 with a stellar oversubscription of 74 times. He also is an MD of Nuclear Healthcare Limited, which is a radiology vertical that focuses on cyclotrons for diagnosing and monitoring in oncology. Now welcoming Mr. Shailesh Haribhakti, so please come on the stage. So he is the chairman of Haribhakti & Co. LLP. Mr. Shailesh V. Haribhakti is an inspiring thought leader who defines Haribhakti Group's future. Over decades of hands-on professional involvement, he has worked through many engagements which have defined the next steps at Haribhakti Group. His passion for quality is reflected in the ISO 9000 certification for various processes of the group's operations. He represented India on the Standards Advisory Council of the International Accounting Standards Board. He worked with PBAS, an affiliate of IFC Washington, to establish activity-based costing and strategic planning processes in Polish SMEs as well. Mr. S.V. Haribhakti is a staunch believer in corporate social responsibility, governance, and promoting a greener environment. He actively promotes these causes through forums like CII and the Indian Merchants Chamber by participating in the process of framing regulations and standards. So you may please continue with the session. Thank you.
Thank you. So welcome, Sas.
Thank you.
It's a privilege for me to be with you. Dr. Velumani, you're the techno entrepreneur, you've built business, you've built family, and I wait to listen to your wisdom, your experience, in what connects all that you've done with people in this room, wealth, family offices, and wealth managers. It's a very, very broad invitation.
My story is a story of from a small village to National Stock Exchange. didn't have money, fortunately. I always believe that success in life is delta. Delta is equal to x2 minus x1. And if your x1 was zero, you are certainly going to be very powerful. And fortunately, my x1 was zero. Having said that, did some decision making, sir, time to time. I liked your slide, the last slide, sir, seventh point, frugality. With all said and done, there are only two kinds of people who remained frugal and made it very powerful. The rest have collapsed because they were not frugal. My mother didn't have money at all even to run the family. She brought up 5 children. That was frugal. I had only a 500 rupees to come to Mumbai. I stayed in VT railway platform for 3 nights. Well, I was frugal. I was just a government officer, earned money and saved money to build something for tomorrow. That's frugality. I am running a business for the last 23 years. Never I have borrowed a single paisa. Company always had cash in the balance sheet. That was frugal. And today the company is worth 3,400 crore and I own a 65% of it. That's all frugal. And fortunately, I have 2 children and both of them have still not driven their own cars. They are still on Ola. That means they are frugal. My wife was the most powerful lady. She is no more, unfortunately. She built the family office. Means the entire family members she was connecting, allowing me only to drive the vehicle and managing my family, her family, everything was her capability. She might have created X and she didn't consume 0.01X. That's frugality. So according to me, frugality makes you very powerful and money comes to you. And in fact, I keep telling people money and honey sounds very similar. Honey is collected by honeybee. Money is collected by moneybee. If honeybee falls in honey, it dies. So will be moneybee. So frugality is very important that people continue to do that. Many don't understand what is the difference between expenditure and investments. Those who keep on doing expenditure collapse. Those who keep on doing investments become very powerful. So today, if I believe, what is the problem of big family offices? Papa ne banaya, father made a lot of money. Fortunately, that man didn't consume. And the next generation feels money is something, it comes automatically. And they are struggling to manage the money. And their consumption levels are so high, they have no rights to practice, preach anyone. Because they don't practice.
Absolutely.
So a lot of things are there. Management of money is a big challenge. Not having money is peaceful life. As Alan's slide started, the first slide is money is the problem, starting up the problem. Money is a poison. But people say you must have enough to tell it. I'll take on a few more things. Yeah, when,
thank you
ask
so
the
much.
Next.
Absolutely brilliant. You spoke a slice of my heart. Haribhakti sir, you're a doyen, you're a legend. You are on so many companies. You have your own company, you're on boards. You're so close to family businesses and their dilemmas and their all of that. So from your perspective, what can this all of us here take home?
Well, thank you. The two presentations that I listened to while I was sitting there were so extraordinary. And the wisdom that you shared, sir, just a little while ago, is indeed very close to me. But I will respond to your question by sharing with you the 5 or 6 big ideas that keep me engaged with the family managed businesses that I work with. The primary thing that these family managed businesses have, maybe in the last 5 years, come to grips with is how do you unlock the single stock risk that you are running by having most of your wealth embedded in a extremely valuable single company. And I think a lot of the thinking about how to manage wealth, how to manage the family's equanimity, how to manage the longevity, the legacy, which I liked very much. All of those issues come to the fore when you start thinking about the risk associated with having 90%, 95% of your wealth embedded in a single stock. Many considerations are there. There are very lumpy expenditures which need to be planned for. Most of the families that we are talking about in this room would want their next generation to be educated in international settings, whether it is in Australia or England or Canada or US. The cost of financing that lumpy expenditure is something that I believe needs to get adequate attention. And that's where Akhil's question on trusts becomes perhaps relevant. The other occasions for lumpy expenditures, and which cause many times family anxiety, is the expenditure on marriages. And I've seen it. There's a competition about which marriage was the most memorable. And therefore, what should be the spend that the family should expend to make sure that you are doing the celebration which will keep your so-called reputation, social standing, what your network expects from you, to pull a few words from your slides, which would satisfy the family. And then, of course, long sicknesses. We just had a personal experience of 3 years of my mother-in-law being bedridden. I know what we went through. My wife had to be engaged almost on a daily basis to take care of her. She passed away just 10 days ago. But we know what it takes even in a family as established as my wife's family was, how difficult it is to take care of that kind of long sickness. And I think these are key situations that need to be embedded in the planning and in making sure. And then, because it is so fresh in my mind, how do you make that intergenerational transfer smooth and easy? There's a whole lot of thought process that needs to go into it. And if you know that you are not immortal, which all of us know, but don't behave as if we know it. There are ways to make sure that the transition is smooth. It's so hard to get a probate, for example. It's so very difficult if you don't have the right second names and third names behind assets. The transfer of those assets is a nightmare. Even simple assets like bank balances. I mean, if you don't have the right kind of forethought going into it, without the probate, even the bank balance cannot be used. And therefore, there is a whole lot of planning, a whole lot of intense work that needs to go there. But just to take a little bit of a contrarian view from your slides, I believe that families work best when they celebrate differences. Absolutely. I think the idea ought not to be to bring everybody on the same page. The idea ought to be, in my view, that you celebrate the fact that different parts of the family have different endowments, and that they must be allowed to play to their strengths. And the way to create the ecosystem in the family is to focus your abilities around three things that I believe are critically important for keeping a family sustainably happy. One is, have one larger-than-life project that the whole family, different parts of the family, are all committed to. It could be anything. Building a hospital, building a temple, building a place of worship, It could be anything,
yes,
that the family feels will bring it together. It becomes the occasion for the family to meet on a regular basis. The biggest challenge I am finding today, everybody thinks they are so busy that they don't make time to meet. How can a family be sustained if there is no occasion to meet 3 or 4 times a year? It's just impossible. I believe the other thing which is very critical is to have holidays together, at least one holiday of at least a week, where the I can't get time to speak to my grandchild or play chess with him or her if we are not on holiday. And if that is the case, then it's important that this kind of quality time out, which is on a structured basis, of course I believe very strongly in family councils and all of that.
But your point is very, very valid.
I think it is very important to have that absolutely free-flowing. And the other thing which I'm finding of late becoming extremely popular is social impact investing. Families have now begun to allocate a significant component of their surplus wealth to making investments which have a social impact. I give you an example. There is a person who I can only describe as a mad scientist. He's pursuing a cure for cancer, he's pursuing a cure for non-aging, he's doing all of this stuff. But he wants, his biggest passion is to make sure that people develop larger innate immunity so that they are not visited by disease. He is keen to make sure that that kind of investing happens across the length and breadth of the country. How will the Prime Minister's insurance scheme work if we have the current level of sickness and the current level of sanitation and hygienic conditions and all of that that we have today?
Let me just take you into, and both of you really. At least my perception, is that the current wealth management family office have been trained to think money. Derivatives, money, all of that. So what would you recommend the intent of our being here in a small way is to put some seeds in the community here to be able to develop that awareness.
Absolutely.
There is something beyond money that they could be responsible for. Could you help us put those seeds in this community?
So in Hindi it is told, jo kaam karte hain wo budde hote hain, jo kaam karate hain wo bade hote hain, which means creating employment is only form of creating wealth. I believe any investment, if I am asked to make, I will see how much employment is it creating, not how much wealth it is creating, because wealth creations are very different, but employment creation is my priority. And I believe that every individual who has money has to allocate money for job creation, which in turn will impact the society and help people to live with dignity. Second thing is, whenever, you know, I am now fairly rich, so many wealth managers approach me. The minute I see the designation, I don't respond to that mail, because I don't have that much of wealth also. It's only the stock which I have got.
Yeah.
But I believe that one should not ask for business, one should first raise relationships and raise trust. I think with all said and done, trust is everything, and if you have to do something in future within the family, within the organization, or between anyone elsewhere, trust is the most important.
Absolutely.
And if you have trust, you have the entire world with you. If you have lost it, you have lost everything.
Absolutely.
So I believe that that is something which wealth managers are not keen to invest on. They only show some PowerPoints and ask us to invest. The same man's PowerPoint in next quarter will be very different. Somebody else's PowerPoint, which was very weak, will become very colorful, powerful next quarter. So it's very difficult to go by that. I am of that opinion, a good employment creation, if is in the mind, that addresses corporate social responsibility, that addresses the money which you have created is put into a very good use. I think I am very happy to tell my children have taken up a task. They only told me, Dad, you made money, you please make sure your money you have consumed and then gone. I don't think children nowadays have courage to tell it. And I won't be able to consume it. And if you can imagine what kind of good it can put into, I don't want to create wealth. I want to create employment. I think that's myself, well, I'm very clear.
Super. Fantastic. Super. So let me link.
Absolute.
So let me link something, sir said. You know, you remind me of, you know, we go to family conferences, not family office conferences. And I once went to that doyen of the industry I'm working with. So just after, so a lot of people during tea time and lunch time, a lot of wealth managers come to those conferences. And, you know, and then they give their cards and all. So he will tell me, PM, let us go somewhere else. try and avoid, because they will come and give you some pitch. How do we increase, from your a lot of experience, how can people in this room be attractive? And why didn't this person say, hey, come, I want to talk to you, to this person?
Great question.
I will add some humor there.
Yes, please.
All girls, if they love, they say, they love me, I'm very scared. I will only pick up that girl whom I love. So you need to have patience until I get a love. Similarly, is anybody wealth managers, there are infinite. So if you have wealth, you will only have to fall in love with someone, trust someone and take that journey ahead. Otherwise, you will run away.
Absolutely.
So, sorry.
How should this soft
person, marketing of family office, wealth management, multi-family, how should that be done? That's your question.
If this doyen were to say, PM, I want you to organize a meeting of all the wealth managers in this conference. I want to listen to them. I'm so keen that they are part of my life and my destiny. How to make that?
They are our oneies.
One, I don't know. That's a good question. So how does that happen?
So I'll give practical wing to your question. The first thing I think is important is communication and thought leadership and positioning yourself as somebody who thinks deeply about an issue. Trusts is one example. I mean, there's so much to be thought about. And if you are seen to be a person who can establish safely a structure, that's what's going to make your friend say, please come, I want to talk to this guy. He knows how to make sure that the trust system works well. Or there is the phobia about cross-border investment. I'm not at all surprised when Alan said that the fact that somebody from Australia has thought of investing in India is a big step. I believe it is. But for Indians to invest globally, and if there is a family office person who can talk about this truly in a global context, in terms of risk management, asset allocation, whatever the other tools that are always available, but that experience and that ability to distinguish something that will have a sustained return, if somebody has that kind of thought leadership and knowledge, that would be attractive.
Absolutely. Thank you. So we are challenged for time, but let me now open this to reflections and questions. I know that we've been rather provocative on stage, we seek your tolerance of this provocation. I welcome questions. We are time challenged, so I'm requesting Aditya to help me manage the time as the questions come up. Please state who you're asking this question to so that they may respond appropriately.
Hello, sir. My name is Ram. I'm from Thyrocare. We are an advisor in Australia. My question is to you, sir. Velumani, sir. Question around social responsibility and corporate governance. In our interactions, both from listed companies and family offices, we have noticed there is a higher social responsibility and empathy towards social enterprise and impact amongst the family offices, and interest in actually taking interest towards philanthropy versus a typical listed company, very heavily focused on corporate governance, brings in great level of transparency but very low on social responsibility. You as an entrepreneur who has moved both from a family office and to a listed company owner, what has been your experience of observing your peers in the market, and what lessons we can learn from either way, from social responsibility lessons to family office to listed companies, and corporate governance lessons from listed companies to family offices?
Yeah, as an individual, when you are own owner, you have all rights to do whatever you want. So you can focus a little on family relationships, focus on little on your environment and their comforts and jobs and various things which is called a social responsibility. But once you have become a listed company, your only job is to give returns to the investors. Otherwise, all investors only expect three things: numbers, numbers, and only numbers. So I don't think once you have become a listed company, you have full freedom to do things. In fact, I tell people, before I became listed, I didn't discuss, I only decided. After becoming a listed company, I have not taken any decisions, and I'm only discussing. And in fact, in another way, if I have to tell you, before I became a listed company, my vehicle I was driving looking at the road. Today I am driving the vehicle looking at the speedometer. To that extent, there is enough pressure when you become a listed company. And governance is very strict, especially SEBI being around. Investors also have their own intelligence to see what is happening. And so much so, I have decided not to take my own salary for the last 1.5 years, so that there is no fear for them that their money is very safe. Having said that, there are also some 2% of your total income has PAT has to be spent on CSR. That's being done to a large extent because of the dictation of you have to spend. Otherwise, investors would not love to leave any money anywhere by and large. So that's my take on what you have asked specifically.
Thank you. Any other questions or even reflections?
Good morning. My name is Manoj Belgaonkar.
Sorry?
Manoj.
Yeah, bar. Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Today's businesses, they are working.
To whom are you addressing this question, sir?
To the panel. I don't know who is
okay.
The
go ahead. Go
right
ahead.
One right. Who would okay. Like to take this question. So today, most of the businesses we're looking at resources, maybe both natural and different resources, but
little more louder or keep
yeah.
It closer.
Yeah. So, and the new kind of businesses what are coming up based on the data and the new opportunities what it is giving us. Do you think, and because the kind of influence they carry these days, I mean, talk of Amazon or many such companies. So, do you think at some point of time, family offices will be able to run nations?
Will be able to run nations?
Countries.
The country. The family office running a country.
Yes. Will they be ready? Maybe another 50 years? I don't know. I'm just asking a question.
Interesting. I can't imagine. I have not let my imagination run wild enough to think that a family office could run a country.
Provided you are prime minister and your family can truly run the nation.
Right. No, or you are controlling the prime minister of the country, then you can run. But, yeah.
Okay. I'm getting signals. Just one last question, and then we have tea time and lunch time to interact. Yes, sir.
Very good morning. My name is Pankaj Jain. I'm the founder of Prometheus Global. We are predominantly into cross-border investment and structuring advisory. My question is to Mr. Shailesh Haribhakti ji. You very much touched upon the fact that Indian families are going international, you know, They are actually, you touched upon the point of they planning for the aspiring for sending their children globally for education, also on global investments, to say. The question is that, with your experience, when they look at global scenarios and global jurisdictions where or maybe of their interest or purely from their advisory point, from wealth creation between the three, say, what's the focus? So one first question is, between wealth creation, wealth preservation, and wealth succession, what do you feel is their prime focus? And second, what's more challenging out of the three?
Okay. Let me create a little bit of context for you. Two geographies, India and China, are the only two geographies where savings that families make are made for the purpose of transferring to the next generation. The experience in Canada, US, Australia, and all those places is a large part of the savings is motivated by a desire to take care of your old age. So that's the big difference between what savings are allocated to in terms of the spends. Having said that, I think the most important notion in the minds of a family office should be wealth preservation. And in my experience, I've seen it is. And therefore, the structures that I've seen work well are to create a base of safety in absolutely protected investments which generate returns which will enable the family to maintain its standard of living and make sure that those lumpy costs which we talked about are taken care of. And that's done through trust, through insurance products, through various other ways of planning. And then whatever surplus arises is put into high-risk propositions to make sure that the overall portfolio gets a better yield. So I see this as a very careful, structured way that family offices are beginning to behave. Create that base of capital-protected lump sum which will generate enough income to make sure that your current expenditure is met. Make sure that you put away enough into trusts and other forced savings, if you like, to take care of the events that we talked about, and then take the risk appetite. This is provided you are already out of your single stock risk. If you're still in your single stock risk, then the greatest amount of time and effort has to be spent on seeing how you can get out of that. So that's the
I'll just take 100 seconds I will take. The creators in a family who start from poverty, every family, whether grandfather or father, must have struggled and created. He had romanced with risk. That's how he had got an opportunity to create.
Absolutely.
The second generation is risking with romance. That's where the all pains come into life. I think with all said and done,
yes,
there are only two things. One is security, another is prosperity. There is nothing known as secured prosperity which next generation should understand.
Thank you so much. Absolutely brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Great pleasure.
Wonderful. Hello. Thank you so much.
Velumani.
Thank you.
Lovely.
Thank you. We'll close here.
Ah, okay. Oh, hi, how are you? Good to see you.
Hello.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Aditya.
Thank you.
All the best.
Yeah, I think we're taken. Come.